Snails move so slowly that their behavior is a bit of a mystery. But two graduate students at the University of California Museum of Paleontology used a cool technique, time-lapse photography, to learn some surprising things about snail behavior.
My name is Jann Vendetti. I'm a graduate student in integrative biology. I study marine whelks in the family Buccinidae.
Hi, I'm Scott Fay. I study single-celled marine creatures.
For her dissertation, Jann studied a particular species of marine snail called Kelletia kelletii.
I had a tank of Kelletia for years, and somebody who'd done a thesis on it years ago had fed them shrimp, dead shrimp and fillet fish, dead fish. And one day I was buying shrimp for them, but frankly I felt guilty because none of the shrimp that were available were sustainable. So clams were a better choice than shrimp. So I decided, well, you know, it's possible that they could eat these clams, so I might as well just test it. So I just threw them in the tank, left, checked on them a couple days later. Every single clam was opened and absolutely cleaned out of every speck of tissue. So obviously, the Kelletia in the tank loved it.
Kelletia weren't limited to eating just dead stuff. They could eat live prey. But how?
So one day, I walked into Jan's lab, and she was there taking photos of these snails trying to eat the clams. She's taking a photo every 15 minutes documenting the behavior of these snails. I thought, well, this would be a perfect project to use time-lapse on, because time-lapse is super cool. It lets you see into this other dimension where, like, our normal experience of time is, it just moves at one rate, right? But these creatures, you know, a snail moves pretty slowly. They're famous for that. And they have a different experience of time. Everything happens on a different scale for them.
In time-lapse photography, the camera is controlled by a computer. The camera will take one picture every, say, 10 seconds. Then the computer strings all those photos together, and we can watch them like a movie.
When we watched the time-lapse videos of Kelletia,
We saw that they definitely do wedge, so we'll use its own shell and kind of use it as a lever, and pry it open, and then as it's pried open, but still alive, so it's sort of gruesome, stick its proboscis in, and then eat the inside while the clam or bivalve is still alive. They would orient the bivalve so that they would get a really good sort of shot at wedging it. Yeah. And they would sort of smother it a little bit and then kind of wait for it to open. And this took a long time. This took hours
and
hours.
When you say wait to open, it's like a couple hours. And it's really amazing to see, you know, the clam open slowly and it's like, is it okay? Is it okay? And then in snail time anyway, the snail very quickly shoves the edge of its shell into the opening of the clam.
Right. Okay, so right now we're watching Kelletia kelletii individual H, just about trying to pry open a manila clam, so far unsuccessfully, but what we're watching now is a lot of manipulation.
Yeah, he's trying to figure out what the best way to grab a hold of the clam is so he can get... Oh, yeah, there you see his...
What's whipping around is its proboscis. It's like its mouth. It's, if you think about it, it's like an extension of its mouth, and its mouth is a very long tube. But here you can see it, that it's very likely that it's pried it open enough that it could get its proboscis inside. So the clam that we're seeing now, sadly, is being eaten alive.
Scott and Jann saw that Kelletia used a wedging behavior to open the clamshell. This was exciting because previously people thought Kelletia and its relatives were scavengers and could only eat food items that were already dead. Over the course of this research, Scott and Jann learned something more.
Kelletia, while it was wedging into the clamshells, would also in the process break little parts of its own shell. And that was something we'd never seen before or expected.
Okay, you can see there where the snail is pushing against the edge of the clam, and then right there, you can see where the edge of the snail shell breaks.
That break in the edge of the shell will leave a sort of scar.
It's common to see that the aperture will have breakage and repair marks. Its history of battle wounds, if you will, are still evident on the shell as an adult. So you can see what happened to it throughout its life.
Commonly, this has been used. These breakage patterns have been used to explain when other creatures have been preying upon the snails. But I think a less common interpretation is that that damage can happen when the snail itself is the predator. So that's one of the cool things about this, is that we've got evidence of the shell breaking as they're attempting to feed on the clams.
Scott and Jann's study gives us a new way to interpret the breakage and repair marks on the snail shells. Not just the shells of modern snails, but the fossilized shells of snails that lived in the past.
There's very little different between a snail that died a week ago that you find at the beach and a snail that died 25 million years ago. If that was a well-preserved fossil, there's really no difference between the two. They're both records of that organism's life and life history. When we find this kind of shell breakage pattern in fossil snails, we can infer that they fed in a similar way to Kelletia that we were testing. And we know that they probably wedged open their prey in a similar way. And doing these experiments on modern animals, it's informative in looking at snails of the past and trying to infer their feeding behavior as well.
We can't go back and directly observe these things, so it's really cool to be able to have this tool to be able to infer past behavior from just a shell. From the University of California Museum of Paleontology, this is Scott Fay.
And Jann Vendetti.